Alturas is a quiet, secluded farming community in Polk County, Florida, surrounded by cattle ranches and orange groves. A peaceful, safe district in an isolated region of Southeast America, with houses spread so far that some are situated over a quarter of a mile away from their nearest neighbour. Being such a remote and tranquil location, most families would expect to live their lives here carefree, with little to no crime disturbing the neighbourhood. That can't be said for one family, however, who in the late 80s would be subject to a heinous poisoning which would change the history of Alturas forever. Peggy Carr, a 41-year-old restaurant waitress and mother of three, lived with her husband, Parolin, also known as Pi, on a quiet road in Alturas. Peggy's three children, Dwayne, Alan, and Sissy, were all from a previous marriage, as were Pi's children, Travis, Tammy, and Galena. Both Travis and Dwayne lived at the home with their respective parents, whilst Tammy and Galena resided in a converted garage apartment on the property, along with Galena's daughter Casey. On the 23rd of October 1988, during a shift at the restaurant she worked in, Peggy started to become increasingly unwell, feeling pains in her chest. She decided to go home, and after a few hours, her son Dwayne found her lying on the sofa, struggling to breathe and complaining of an agonizing burning sensation in her feet. Her limbs went numb, she was vomiting, and she could barely walk or speak. As the symptoms continued to manifest, Pi rushed Peggy to hospital where doctors examined her. To their bewilderment, they couldn't establish what was wrong with Peggy, and even suggested that her condition could be psychosomatic, claiming that she may have been under psychological stresses which brought upon physical symptoms. Doctors kept her in hospital under close supervision for 3 days, and in that time she began to feel better as the pain subsided. Unable to come to a conclusion on her diagnosis, Peggy was discharged and sent home, thankful that her health had returned to normal. However, 4 days later, on the 30th of October, the same symptoms returned, but this time much worse than before. Peggy's body once again felt like it was on fire, going completely numb to the point where she eventually went blind from not being able to open her eyelids. She was once again admitted to hospital, where doctors were still stumped at what was causing such physical trauma. Soon after, both Travis and Dwayne began to feel similar symptoms of burning sensations in their feet and hands, and were also rushed in for medical treatment. With paralysis setting in, and now unable to talk, Peggy would describe the overwhelming pain she was in with her sister, Shirley, in sign language, which they fortunately knew since their parents were both deaf. It wasn't long before other symptoms started to emerge, with huge clumps of her hair beginning to fall out. It was at this point that doctors began to understand what may have been causing the family harm, and took urine samples from the three patients. After analysing the results, it was confirmed that they were suffering from the effects of a poisoning, in particular, the chemical thallium. Thallium is a highly noxious metal which was previously used in products such as rat poison and insecticide, but was banned in the US in 1972 due to its toxicity from accidental exposure. In its purest form, thallium is tasteless and odourless, and ingesting it can lead to vomiting, hair loss, organ and nerve system failure, and in some cases, death. For the average person, consuming as little as 1 gram of thallium can be lethal. Peggy was found to have over 20,000 times the natural normal amount of thallium in her system, with the two boys having a much smaller exposure. Over time, Duane and Travis made a full recovery, but Peggy, unfortunately, slipped into a coma within a week. It was clear to doctors and police that something, or rather someone, had poisoned the Carr residence, and Polk County Detective Ernie Mincy was assigned to find out. A thorough search was made of the Carr's house, with the garden, water supply, and cleaning products all thoroughly checked. Over 400 samples were taken from the property, with only one of these testing positive for the deadly poison. Stored away underneath the kitchen sink, an 8-pack of Coca-Cola bottles were found, all containing varying levels of thallium. 3 of the bottles were full, but 3 were empty, 2 of which were consumed by Peggy. After being unknowingly poisoned by the first bottle, she had consumed the second one after returning home from hospital to keep her fluid levels up, not realizing she was merely making her situation worse. Worrying that there could be potentially thousands of contaminated bottles in circulation, the Coca-Cola company was contacted to investigate if the poisoning could have originated at one of their production lines. But after receiving no other reports from its consumers, it was quickly established that the contamination must have been local to the car's supply. Microscopic tool marks were found on the caps of the bottles, showing that they had been pried carefully open and then reattached after being mixed with the deadly metal. It was now evident that someone wanted to hurt the Carr household, and the police were soon on the hunt for the person responsible. Suspicion initially fell upon that of Peggy's husband, Pi, as stories of marital troubles between the two began to emerge. 6 months after marrying her in 1987, Peggy supposedly caught Pi having an affair after he began working unusually late and staying away from home for long periods. She left Pi and moved out, but after begging for her forgiveness, she eventually returned home, although the relationship between the two had significantly changed. During the time of her first poisoning, Pi was actually away on a hunting trip out of town, which further put him under scrutiny from investigators. However, after further testing, it was concluded that all of the family had been exposed to varying degrees of thallium, including Pi himself. The theory that he was responsible soon faded, as it was unlikely he would attempt to poison his own children, as well as himself, with such a deadly substance. Nobody seemed to know who had actually purchased the Coca-Cola, and everyone took for granted that it must have been someone else in the house that had brought them home. The family all said how they also never bought Coca-Cola, and that they usually drank Pepsi, which gave more reason for the police to believe that this could have been from an outsider who didn't know about the Carr's preferences. The Carrs admitted that they rarely locked their doors, since the neighbourhood was so peaceful, giving a potential suspect an opportunity to plant the drinks in the home without anyone knowing. Further investigation of the property led detectives to find an interesting note crumpled up and shoved into a drawer. Inside an envelope addressed to Pi was a post-it note with a typed message saying, "You and all your so-called family have 2 weeks to move out of Florida forever, or else you all die. This is no joke." When questioned about this note, Pi mentioned that he received it 3 months prior, but simply decided to brush it off as an idle threat from his neighbour, who the Carrs had a few altercations with in the past. The fact that Pi's unusual name was spelt correctly meant that it must have been someone he knew, and with only one other house opposite them, he was sure it was his neighbour who sent the note. Mincy decided it was time to interview the residents of Alturas, and in particular the Carrs' neighbours, to try and get an understanding of who could have been behind such a terrible crime. Without informing them of the menacing note, most people who were spoken to were very sympathetic to Peggy's condition, except for one person, the neighbour opposite. The same man that Pi accused of sending the note to his family to leave Florida said nervously when questioned by the police, "Maybe someone wanted them to move out of the neighbourhood." Mincy saw this man as the prime suspect, and police began to draw up a profile and check his background. Little did they know, but they were about to discover that this was no ordinary resident of Alturas, and that in fact, the Carrs were not the only people that he had poisoned in the past. The neighbour opposite was this man, 39-year-old George Trepal, a self-taught chemist and computer programmer who lived with his wife, Diana Carr. Whilst unemployed at the time, George was considered a highly intelligent individual. He was a psychology graduate with an IQ of around 150 and also a member of Mensa. He met his wife Diana through a Mensa murder mystery weekend, which they would regularly attend. Diana herself was highly intelligent, being one of the first female orthopedic surgeons in America. The pair moved to Alturas after marrying in 1981 and enjoyed living in peace and solitude, so much so that they didn't even own a television. Despite this seemingly innocent lifestyle, however, George's history was quite the opposite. Whilst studying at Clemson University in South Carolina, George was notorious for experimenting with illegal drugs, but not in the way that you would expect. He would deliberately spike other people, usually without their knowledge or awareness, to see how they would behave to the effects. One time, George and his friend would pick up hitchhikers and give them cookies laced with drugs without their knowing, just to laugh at their reactions. On another occasion, he coated his door and fridge handles with hallucinogens, which would absorb into the skin when touched, after finding out that people were sneaking into his room. After graduating from university, George was arrested in 1975 for operating a large methamphetamine lab and spent 3 years in prison. Interestingly, a byproduct in the creation of methamphetamine is thallium, the deadly substance which would be responsible for poisoning his future neighbours. After his release, he supposedly had turned his life around and wanted to make a clean, fresh start. 6 years later, however, when Peggy and her children moved into Pye's house, their peaceful existence had been shattered. With the house opposite now overcrowded with residents, George and Diana became increasingly irritated by some of the actions of the Carrs. Travis and Duane would regularly drive their loud ATVs around the neighbourhood, sometimes trespassing onto George's property, and their cats would be chased constantly by Peggy's dogs. This disturbance infuriated Diana, who frequently complained to Peggy and Pye about the noise, but these were seemingly ignored. The relationship between the families hit a peak when Diana confronted Peggy in October 1988, a week before she was first poisoned. After screaming at her to keep the noise down, Diana exclaimed, "You won't get away with this. This isn't over." With all this information, police were convinced that George Trepal was responsible for the poisoned Coca-Cola, but didn't have enough evidence to prove it in a court of law. The importance of obtaining that proof became even more crucial when, sadly, after 4 months of suffering, Peggy passed away after her life support was discontinued. George was now considered a potential murderer. Police knew they needed to get close to George to get more evidence for a conviction, and therefore planned for an officer to go undercover in Alturas. Susan Gorek, a Polk County police detective, was assigned to the case in order to obtain evidence that George was the killer. Posing as a fellow Mensa member by the name of Sherry Gwynn, her story was that she was new to the area and currently going through a difficult divorce from her oppressive husband. Susan was able to get an invite to the 4th annual Mensa Murder Mystery Weekend, which was actually organised this time by George and Diana themselves. At these events, participants would wear costumes and take on individual personas, playing as characters in a story, acting out various murder scenarios. On the leaflet for the event, one of the scenarios read as follows. Few voodooists believe they can be killed by psychic means, but no one doubts that they can be poisoned. When a death threat appears on the doorstep, prudent people throw out all their food and watch what they eat. Hardly anyone dies from magic. Most items on the doorstep are just a neighbour's way of saying, I don't like you, move or else. The similarities between this and Peggy's murder were strikingly obvious, with the victim also receiving a threatening note as part of the plot. Susan, posing as Sherry, approached George at the event and befriended him by complimenting his efforts to organise the weekend. She later mentioned how he was very smart, like an encyclopedia, and very easy to talk to. She forged a friendship with the couple and began spending more time with them after the event, especially with George. Susan would call the house frequently and record the conversations in the hopes that George would eventually slip up and confess to the poisoning of Peggy, but he never once brought it up. Susan would continue to spend time with George, going on picnics, having dinners, and eventually confiding in him on her fake messy divorce. At one point, when opening up about her dilemma, George suggested that she should blackmail her husband or perhaps send him some poisoned flowers so she can get what she wanted. Susan also noticed that he had been reading the Agatha Christie novel, The Pale Horse, which coincidentally centres around the use of phallium as a method of murdering some of the characters. Despite all these signs hinting towards George's guilt, the police needed something more concrete, and after 8 months, they finally got their chance. In November 1989, Diana had decided that she wanted to set up a new practice in Sebring, Florida, which was roughly 40 miles away from Alturas. As such, her and George were planning to move out of town and rent out their home. Susan pounced on this opportunity and asked George if she could rent the house from them, as she was in the market for a new place anyway. The very next month, Susan moved into the property whilst the two were away in Sebring, and police scoured the house for as much evidence as they could get their hands on. A search of the garage revealed that George was in possession of many different chemicals, one of which being a small brown bottle holding a white substance containing traces of phallium. Investigators also found out that George was producing homemade wine and owned a device that was used to seal metal caps onto bottles. One thing they didn't expect to find, however, when searching through the property, was a secret passageway inside the house which led to a room full of bondage equipment and a strange-looking mannequin. It was certainly an odd discovery, but police didn't feel this was relevant in the case against George being a murderer. With the search complete, Susan wanted one last attempt to see if she could get George to confess to Peggy's murder, so later asked to meet him, still posing as Sherry, at a local McDonald's with a hidden camera. She informed him that two officers had visited her whilst he was away, asking about a murder in the area, and she handed him the officers' business cards. George never directly confessed to any involvement, but was startled by this, and told Susan nervously,
I hope I'm not a prime suspect.
A few months later, on the 7th of April 1990, police obtained a search warrant and visited George and Diana in Sebring. In an attempt to stop them from entering, Diana blocked the officers' entrance and had to be physically restrained to allow them inside. When searching the home, they found a multitude of suspicious items, including multiple books about poison. One of these had been written by George himself, titled Chemistry for the Complete Idiot: Practical Guide to All Chemistry, which contained photocopied pages from a book entitled Poison Detection in Human Organs. One of the pages even explored the use of phallium, and was so detailed it was described by prosecutors as a general poisoning guide. Just when police thought they had enough to convict George, another bizarre twist left them with even more concern of the Florida man's true intentions. Searching through the property, investigators found another secret room, just like their home in Alturas, but this one was much more sinister. Inside this dark chamber, the windows had been sealed shut and there was no door handle on the inside. There was a solitary bed with shackles on the wall and a makeshift pulley system designed to lift a person on and off of it. Diana stated that it was merely a darkroom for photography and that the shackles were props for their murder mystery weekends. Susan, on the other hand, had been invited to their Sebring house on numerous occasions but was never available, and she believed that the room was a prison that could have been waiting for her eventual arrival. The couple protested their innocence, and whilst she was never implicated in any of the crimes, Diana believed that evidence such as the Fallian bottle was planted in her home to set George up. George was arrested and charged with one count of murder, 6 counts of attempted murder, 7 counts of poisoning, and 1 count of tampering with a consumer product. The trial began in 1991. With George's defence team suggesting that all the evidence that had been collated was weak and circumstantial, and nothing actually proved that George had poisoned the Coke bottles himself. In fact, George was so convinced that he would be found innocent that he arranged for a ride home for the last day of his trial. That wasn't to be, however, as on the 5th of February 1991, George was found guilty of all charges and sentenced to death the next day. Following on from the success of the 15-month undercover operation, Susan Gorick was named 1991 Deputy Sheriff of the Year by the Florida Sheriff's Association and received a check for $1,000. Despite always defending George's innocence, Diana divorced him in 1996 and went on to remarry before dying aged 69 in October 2018. Peggy's widowed husband Pye also went on to remarry in July 2020 at the age of 76, with Dwayne, Travis and the rest of the children also continuing on with their lives into adulthood. George Trepal still remains on death row to this day at the Union Correctional Facility in Florida, and still maintains his innocence despite losing all of his appeals. Whilst Peggy's suffering can never be reversed, the poisonous mind responsible for her death will stay behind bars for the rest of his life, and George Trepal's toxic tendencies will remain locked away forever. Thanks everyone for watching this video. If you enjoyed it, please give me a thumbs up, and if you haven't already, please subscribe to my channel. Just want to thank everyone so far for their support, and I really hope you enjoyed listening to this case. If you want me to cover any stories in particular, feel free to contact me. My email is on my YouTube channel, or alternatively, you can follow and message me on Twitter and on Reddit. The links are just on screen there. Thanks very much for watching. See you on the next one.